For those of you who don't know, we were working with the EPA on, and we got permission from the city council at a work session a few months ago to take the plan, confer with stakeholders, including government agencies, and get their in. We got their input, and that's what resulted in some revisions of the plan. The purpose of those revisions is not to take away from the themes, because you know the themes are connectivity, heritage, thriving neighborhoods, thriving commercial. You know. So we're not taking away from the themes. What we did was just clarify the strategies, so they're definitely actionable. You know, but with that said, we're still interested in hearing from all of you, all residents in all three neighborhoods, to make sure that these strategies reflect your wishes as well. Right. Yeah. So, and Bart helped revise the map exhibits too, and insert those. So you can also find these in the plan. And we also brought copies. In case you'd like to have a hard copy, you're welcome to take one. You can look at it now or later. Or take, we got 10 copies here. So, great. Does anyone want to have one in their hand right now?
I will.
Sure. And the PDF of this plan, PDF is available on the internet too. So if you prefer to look at PDFs, the same things on the internet.
I'm going to interrupt you a couple times to supplement. One of the critical elements about this plan is, the purpose of this outreach is getting you to take the survey after you've read the plan. We have physical surveys, or you can just go online, SurveyMonkey style, and fill it out there. So if you don't fill out the survey, then we basically fail.
Right. Thank you, Mark. So yeah, to reiterate that, we kind of tie it all together. After we do our meetings with the neighborhoods, and after we get comments and surveys, then we'll incorporate all that feedback to revise the plan once more. That way it reflects precisely what the neighborhoods want. Then we give that to the Planning and Zoning Commission. And the Planning and Zoning Commission will make a recommendation to City Council to adopt the plan, to formally adopt the plan. And that's where we want to go. Because if we get the City Council to adopt the plan, that gives it a lot more weight when it comes to paying for projects, especially capital projects, you know, public projects. Whenever Lexi may have has informed, you know, the folks in the Begin Work Group, has educated the folks in the Begin Work Group that our city, we have a capital improvement program. And so to really see some physical improvements in the built environment, you got to advocate for those projects, and they're prioritized. But when you get a plan that's adopted, that gives it a lot more weight. So that way it gets higher up there in the capital improvement plan. So that's the real purpose of all that.
And also, when you're applying for grants, 9 times out of 10, there's a question on the grant that says, does this appear in an existing plan? So we want to answer yes to that whenever we're...
CDBG, and, you know, anything grant related, whether it's CDBG or other grants that you find.
Sure.
So that's gonna be the big difference from where we were, you know, before, in the years working with the EPA on revitalization. You know, it's just going through and developing the plan. But once we get this adopted, that's going to go a long way towards getting the funding and getting these things done in the community. Right. Any questions so far? Okay. And then this is the survey, again, that Bart constructed. And if you prefer, you know, like SurveyMonkey on the internet, which is really handy. So it's the same survey. If you're comfortable with doing the survey on the internet, great. The link to that survey is on pueblo.us/CSRP. You hear that, folks? Pueblo.us.
It's just that
CSRP stands for Colorado Smelter Revitalization Plan, CSRP. But you're all welcome. Any one of you are welcome to take the hard copy survey. Take, you know, and I would suggest, do you think it'd be more effective if they took it home now or filled it out here at the meeting?
I would highly recommend doing it online, because that just saves your taxpayer dollars in me and Alan tally.
I looked at it, I didn't fill it out because I just,
Keeps people from filling out more than one online and so forth?
usually there's a you register. IP or email address, I believe.
Like it recognizes your computer has like an address, so it's like, oh yeah, you already served, you already filled out the survey, so you're good. But this is, let me give a copy of this to the secretary, and then if anyone of you are welcome to.
Where do we return? If we do have a hard copy, we return.
The city planning department.
Actually, we have a folder. We're going to leave here to start.
Yeah.
And at the end of the process, we'll
flip folders.
So, yeah. So, Jeff, if you don't mind, see this little folder says completed surveys?
Yes.
Just have people just come here and just.
Well, yeah, they can do it right here. Sure.
Yeah.
So,
we'll leave copies with you.
Do you only have 10 surveys?
For now, but we can always make more.
Okay.
And
cool. So, what do you think the odds are of people actually having curiosity and coming here and looking at this in the future?
Word of mouth? Could spread quickly.
So, tied to that question is because there are certainly people that don't go on the internet.
Right.
They don't read the news. So, is there some sort of door? Bag that we can, you know. Need?
Oh yeah, Lexi can talk about that.
Got you. Yeah. So, what I'm also trying to do. And if anybody wants to volunteer, what I'm doing is for every, you know, I think it's 5 or 10 hours. A volunteer time, I'm giving $25 Visa gift cards for helping, but we have bags that we intend on using, and just instead of door hangers, putting them there. And so the information from the survey can go in there, the slip if they wanted to log on online, and then a couple of other resources too, like the food pantry information, and we'll be hanging those just on random doors throughout the neighborhoods, hopefully in the next coming weeks.
I want to acknowledge the health department for being a partner on this, because Lexi and our public health department, public department of health and environment, have been great partner on this, because they've offered to pay for the cost of outreach. You know, the postcards, the flyers, public notice, and then this, you know, the actual direct engagement of hanging, you know, going out to the neighborhoods and putting them on doors. So it's tremendous, and that goes a long way.
The health department with the BPN committee has really been great assistance to us, to everybody actually.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And that's I'm really proud of that, because the BEGIN work group, which spun off from the health department grant about almost 3 years ago, that's really done, I think, great things in getting outreach to the community. It's served as a great model for outreach and getting, you know, I think if we hoped originally that we could scale that to other neighborhoods in the future, that type of activity. So
there's a couple of things on that chart I probably think we should point out.
Sure.
As they're specifically related to you guys in the Grove.
So, okay.
I will step up for a second.
Okay.
So I just wanted to go see this chart right here kind of represents the, thanks. Meat potatoes of the plan, what the actual actionable items are. Some of them have been modified from the original plan, but I just want to take an opportunity to discuss them with you guys directly. The original plan had are you guys familiar with a gateway treatment is? The recommendation of the plan was a southern gateway to the Riverwalk, but we had a little bit of discussion about that in the planning department. And the problem that we saw with that is if you put a Bojohntown gateway and a southern gateway to the Riverwalk, where's the gateway to the Grove? Do you just drive by the Grove? So instead of doing that, I think it would be better to see a gateway to the Riverwalk and a gateway to the Grove.
So one on each side of those
bridges. If you're coming this way, says that, and then you would kind of do that with most of the signs because of maybe over at Santa Fe. You know, when you start going up the hill, you know, it says, you know, coming down the hill, it says, welcome to the Grove. Going up the hill, it says,
the two drop, that could be
precisely. So sure. Kind of double purpose, instead of just having like one sign on the side of the street that says you're down here, it's kind of dual purposing. So going one way, it says you're going this way.
So where do you think those signs are going to be?
Where do I think? Well, the planning department did not come to a definitive decision on that, more the philosophy behind it. So obviously, I go back to you guys. I would envision the Grove, personally, I would envision the Grove right at the end of the Water Tower Place, where I think Spring
kind of cuts in, or like creates some, what's it called, an iron, iron hand, what is that called? The pan iron? Flat iron.
Flat iron, yeah.
So we're right around there.
There's a really nice shoe.
Yeah. Because we've been talking to the railway about doing Buckham to the Grove when you go from Allen Town down.
Yeah.
And they have agreed. So,
oh, great.
Yeah, we've been talking to them.
Yeah, that's great.
We have now you're leaving the room.
Yeah, well, I would say, I think there would be a sort of kind of uniformity between the signage,
exactly.
You know, and the different players, but
sure.
Yeah. But other than that, it's a weight problem.
It also slows people down.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
When you do surveys, because I've done that around the world when we've done transportation surveys, that kind of signage does help slow people down.
Is there going to be opportunity for the neighborhoods to participate in the design of the gateways?
I would assume, yeah.
Yeah.
And this could be an error on my part. I'm not sure. I was under the impression that Spring Street is where you're going to get access to the levee train. But I was told it was Clark the other day.
That's what I heard. I heard it was Clark.
Okay.
It's
right
in front of
I'll modify this in the plan to be on Clark Street. But one of the ideas that comes out in the plan are these ideas that's what the pink here represents these commercial corridors, and blue represents these residential corridors. And that's kind of just like a design standards almost, and just we have a lot of design standards downtown, you know, for what streets are going to look like. And part of the discussion that came out of this is that in order to bring that, we want to bring that to other areas in the city for the most part, too. So you have kind of uniform corridors, or at least gives kind of a sense of, not wholly uniform, but at least
consistency.
Yeah, precise. And one thing that's important to note is, a commercial corridor is going to be different than a residential corridor. So a lot of the current philosophy of the planning department is that a commercial corridor, you don't want to put bikes on the street. You want to have big enough bike paths so they can be completely separate from, you know, the 30 and 40 mile an hour traffic. But it doesn't mean you don't want nice trees on the side of the street and trees, in the median, if you can, to enhance shade and, beautification. So what we've designated a commercial corridor, we kind of modified a little bit. Northern is the same, but we wanted to, we saw Santa Fe over here as an opportunity. It's remiss not to acknowledge that as a commercial corridor, even though it's not, fully built up, but
it's the one way the city can start taking a little back from the county.
Yeah.
Because they keep taking all of our revenue.
Well, yeah.
Property tax revenue. I mean, they just ate up the Safeway on the east side.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how much did that generate a year in property tax? About 50, 60 grand with the schools?
I'm not here to discuss that.
I'm just saying, I think at that corridor right there, you need to have a Costco, a Sam's Club, a movie theater, condos.
It's a high traffic.
That was my idea.
And I think
that would be the visioning.
My
heart sold it to
a lot of.
I don't want to sound like Rick.
No, that's okay. I'm
okay, go on. Yeah, I'm going to overstep.
I'm going to keep talking so I can sit down again.
Go ahead.
So that is identifying that, and importantly, especially for the Grove, is, and maybe you guys want to discuss this as far as, I know that you have some of the worst streets as far as skateboarding, in the whole downtown.
You just look right out there.
I skate on it. It's very difficult. It's kind of like sand. We got to get at least one residential corridor here that kind of leads off Santa Fe. And the difference between a residential corridor is actually putting on-street bike lanes and slowing the streets down and not, forcing the bikes on the street. And you do want to kind of put those next to high traffic areas so that you know that you don't have to go all the way out of your way to get on a safe street, but, it's a lot more easy to ride on this street than perhaps northern. So we want to connect that Santa Fe section to the river trail, and this is a great opportunity to take one of the streets in the Grove and
make it all nice and put, you know, bike lines on it so that you're just, you know, riding through to get to the on the levee trail. Yeah. So that was a slight modification to that would affect you guys' plan. And let's see if there's anything else that pertains directly to you. See, they have lighting with a steel mill, which is a really cool idea. But you could also light up the water tower.
Yeah, Greg was telling me about an idea about lighting the towers in Pueblo. He's already worked on that.
Five and six should definitely be
next. Yeah, we have 25.
Yeah. Oh, that's
for the 100th commemoration of the flood, June 25th. So we're going to do a preliminary one in the winter.
So and you guys will have a lot, and especially at the end of the survey, there's a comment section, or if you say, hey, number two, this is cool, but, you know, we should add this, and that. You know, you can build on any one of these ideas. So I'm all for it, because, you know, this is kind of the start of a larger revamping of our neighborhood plans and trying to get them consistent. I think there was one more that was on my mind to affect you. No, I think I touched on most of them. I'm going to give it back to Alan. I did identify, and this map over here is your existing and a future bike network. I take responsibility for this. I identified B Street, that connection between B Street. As could be a potential access point to get, because it's so obvious.
It's very obvious.
So obvious that I kind of use it all the time. So,
two B.
Yeah, the two B's, you know, where you gotta go over the road.
I mean, I go through it all the time.
Exactly. Yeah. And I've seen, you know, it's a no-brainer. If there could be negotiations, you just get a fence along there, you know, we don't want to mess with anyone's property, but we do want to get the Grove access downtown.
Right.
We designed the way to be able. All right, that's all I got, guys.
Well, there used to be a bridge.
Thank you.
C Street. The old.
I heard that, yeah.
Yeah, the old C Street. So,
yep.
Is there a tree program in Pueblo?
I don't know. Do you know if there's a tree program? I think it's probably a question for Parks and Rec. Might be able to speak to that.
There are none. Huh? Trees, please.
Trees, please. Like,
yeah.
That's Gene and Jamie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right, we need a robust urban forest. Something like that.
No.
Yeah. Because we're doing another grant for Water Tower Place for 400 trees around our perimeter. So we're writing that right now.
Well, anything you learn from irrigation, spread it. Spread that knowledge, because I could use that for my house.
We have six wells, and we're secretly going to use one of them.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions? For us, Eric?
Where does the you were speaking that you're working on getting some brownfield money, where does that work into this plan, and then what sites, I guess, are you working on now and possibly in the future?
Yeah, that's true. The brownfields grant is indirectly related to this. The brownfields grant is another EPA program.
Is this phase two?
What it was Brownfield's grant application for the city of Pueblo in the amount of $300,000 to provide for phase one environmental assessments of about 18 sites. And we identified a core area. So the Grove is, I think the Grove wasn't necessarily identified as the key area, but we focused downtown as a key area for that, because we figured if we concentrate on downtown redevelopment, that'll spur reinvestment, not only in there, but in the adjacent communities, you know, because it's, you know, it's the whole economy. If you develop our downtown, we get land reused and tax on the tax rolls, that's gonna be good for everybody.
Is that phase one that's already been received?
The grant, so the grant talks about a phase one and a phase two.
Because I'm talking to Shelly Dunham about phase two is $750,000.
Well, and that could be, maybe that's a future grant.
It is a future grant.
Okay.
It is available.
Right, right. So
I just want to be clear.
Right.
It's a lot of money there.
So to answer your original question, it is indirectly related, because what happens downtown is going to indirectly impact or benefit the Grove.
And as Pueblo gets a good reputation for following through, Pueblo already has a good reputation for brownfields program. This is some stuff we did in Midtown in the neighborhood near there, the
Pepper Sauce Bottoms or something?
No, is it? Yeah, I think so. Yeah. So that was some successful brownfields work in the past. And so if we do that downtown, that's gonna be good for us in the future as we concentrate in other neighborhoods as well with other grant applications.
Well, that area between Salt Creek Bridge and the Santa Fe coming together there, the bottom of the hill, it seems like a lot of that would be eligible for that type of money as far as all of that for
Yeah, because a lot of industrial looking stuff.
That's all, straight industrial. It just seems like you wipe that slate clean with their money to do it.
It's kind of
redeveloped within.
Right. Well, keep that in mind.
I think that area revitalizing is going to help this area 10 times more than anything that happens downtown.
And in many other cities, I mean, this is still the center of downtown. It's just, it hasn't been developed.
Well, it's cool. We have the ability to grow with it.
Yeah, exactly.
Like Springs or any other places there.
And isn't that zone still not been determined? A lot of that zoning out there hasn't been. That's that undefined area.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that area.
Future land use.
It hasn't been determined.
Indeed.
Right. So just for the people listening, the area near Moffitt Street is a special redevelopment or special development area for future land use purposes. So if there's ever especially along Santa Fe Drive. Santa Fe Drive heading out towards the Mesa, that when people start redeveloping that's going to probably trigger like a master plan, and we would like to see a master plan for that area where that would guide future, development of that whole area. So that would be good to see that in the future.
Well, I got 12 acres of it, so I hope that's
but the truth comes.
Any other thoughts, questions?
On the survey, what are the limits on the responses in terms? Is it 160 characters or what is it?
No, most of the responses put it as high priority, from high priority to this is not going to help.
Okay.
And then each of those responses gets a point total. So then we tally the point total.
There's
based
no free form?
At the end. Yeah.
That's what I'm curious. The free
form. Yeah. At the end.
So it is data driven, it's quantitative
in
the method, but there is a lot of open room for comment at the end.
Good, that's what I want. Yeah. What are the limits on that?
Just sky's the limit.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
That's good. Okay, good.
Right, you run out of space, just email us.
That's a very powerful idea.
And then I have a question too, Alan and Bob, on that commenting piece. So what does it look like with incorporating those comments and that free form into the plan? Because I don't know if that warrants an appendix type of section that talks
about
that.
Is the plan that we are going to have the data from the survey results as an appendix to the plan.
Okay.
And we can talk about it in the staff report to the Planning and Zoning Commission. We can acknowledge, we can summarize comments. We can kind of summarize trends of comments. And that'll definitely be in the background papers for this Planning and Zoning Commission.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
I have one more comment.
Sure.
I really like the new trails that you guys got built. Super, super nice. That trail on the levee is going to be excellent. Where you connect to downtown.
Yeah. Well, I'm complaining. I live downtown, so I'm complaining that. But I can't even get to that trail. But you guys got your own access little
status. So you know the status?
You know, talking to Jeff and other people in the neighborhood, we still have an interest in exploring the sculpture park idea.
Right.
And I did call Steve Myers, and I haven't been able to get him to call me back. And since you guys are kind of leading the effort on behalf of the city, if you could just approach him on behalf of the
next time I'll ask our director Scott to, next time he sees our director Steven, to just be like, hey, please talk to the Grove about that sculpture park.
We just want to see if it's a possibility.
Kind of get it on the radar.
Yeah.
Who owns that property now?
Are there examples of people who have punctured the covenant to see how far you can do, like the sculpture part? Are there other examples? Because you can only go down so far, and then you're restricted.
We've been talking. We don't think we need to.
We don't think we have to disturb.
Yeah, because it's a ground level below. It's not on the mountain. It's
right. But any time you can only break the surface of any of those.
I don't think we really need to do that.
I don't think we do either.
That would be awesome because that's usually the problem.
That's
unless you break the
covenant. We just need to put pads. Yeah, just concrete pads.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Yeah. That's where
pretty straightforward.
Like foundations. You violate the covenant. So.
Yeah, and I think that's a problem that's easily addressed.
Yeah, that would be awesome because it's a perfect place.
Yeah. And cool. You know, it has a lot of attractiveness as far as for the whole city, not just right. For the Superfund site. And it kind of blends into the Artwork deal too.
Right.
Plus, at Water Tower Place, we are actually talking about relinquishing that spur to be a pedestrian walkway like the High Line in New York. So that would connect this sculpture park right to Water Tower Place. So we've already done the designs for that.
Yeah, so that would be a really nice
corner. Because we need another access point, because our entrance to Water Tower Place will be here on D Street, we're not out in the front. So that would be our only pedestrian entrance to Water Tower Place.
That would be cool because, you know, by the time running lights gets developed and
right.
Exactly. So nice. Very
far. I'm pushing for that because we're not putting mail carts on the other side.
Jeff?
So there's supposedly a walk-in bike bridge that supposedly the contract's been let. Do you know anything about that?
Oh, that's
going to be by Main Street?
That's is that the Arkansas River or Arkansas River Trailway Project?
I think
they're building a bridge. Yeah.
So it connects the two sides of the levee.
Right.
Yeah. Do you know the status of that?
It's got funding, so that's a lot farther than a lot of projects. So I'd expect that soon.
Yeah, because I think our colleague Barrett, who's the planner responsible for that, has been talking with, I think, doing either the RFP for bidding out to a contractor, or they had since selected a contractor and they're just working out the contract.
Yeah, that's right. She was trying to, because they're type of bridge suspension.
Yeah.
So
they're in the design right now.
Right. So the design
for that's a big deal. I mean, it just connects and you get this nice loop going on both sides.
Yeah.
Except no access to downtown. Sorry, I'm a loud mouth when it comes to I like a full complete network of connectivity.
What about the tunnel under the depot? Then you can connect.
That's what I was saying to
the
beginning.
It's in the plan. There's a pedestrian promenade that goes under the tracks there between the depot and takes you up to the levee, and then you can connect to the two bridges before 4th Street and the one here between Central, you know, between Main and
really? Because I said that, but
it's in the drawings.
I never even saw it in the drawings. So
it's in the drawings. If you look at it, there's these dotted lines.
I thought there was one that came directly down from the Union Avenue bridge that went.
Well, that's there too, but this one actually goes right underneath the tracks. Huh. So there's a central one, a levee access to.
Just like I said.
All right, good.
That's scary.
It makes sense. It's short
enough, so you don't have to go through all those steps.
Yeah, it's short. It's short. You can see the light. Oh, yeah. Because we're doing that Water Tower Place. We've got two tunnels that connect to the river walk to get in the car.
Oh, okay.
So we have the same issue because as soon as you, I reached out to James Terrell and two other light artists to see if we can do a light installation.
Oh, that's smart. That's really smart.
Sorry,
he's good.
Do you guys got any more questions about the CSRP?
Yeah.
No. Do you have any more shelves?
Just to reiterate, definitely most importantly, the most effective things you can do is fill out that survey, and I'm gonna reiterate what I've heard to the Grove group, just to kind of reiterate what I've heard as far as what you've been discussing. But if, you know, any further ideas, you're always welcome to email it, give it. And also spread the word, very important, just like Bart said, word of mouth.
Okay.
Talk about this thing as much as possible because we need comment by July 22nd. That's
so
when
I'm
the
also,
window closes for this comment.
I have probably 400 postcards through Nextdoor because I'm one of the mediators. So I have free direct to mailbox postcards. So I can put the survey link and everything on that, and it'll go directly to their mailbox.
I think that'd be a good idea.
I can do that easily.
Well, yeah, and maybe if you want, because we definitely
I can
are
do the door handles too.
Right.
Free. I'll do them for free for them.
Because maybe we'll coordinate on that, because the health for mailing over 3,000 postcards to every single address in Bessemer, Eilers, / and the Grove. And
I've never gotten one, and I live in one.
Well, no, they haven't been sent.
It hasn't been sent. But Lexi, do you know when those postcards might be mailed out approximately?
We are hoping to get those sent out next week. But I can hold off if we needed to, but
No, go ahead and send them. Because what I'm thinking is maybe what we can do. See, Gregory.
Yeah.
So the health department is going to mail those postcards next week. So like in a week, so 10 days from now,
right,
people are going to get these postcards. And be like, what is this about?
Right.
And half of them are going to be like, well, whatever. But so then like 2 weeks later,
some.
You follow
I
up.
I could follow up some.
Yeah.
So I can do the free door hangers.
Yeah.
Or I can do postcards.
Yeah.
And those are free through next door.
Right on. And hit this neighborhood, because this neighborhood.
We have 228 addresses.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
What about this neighborhood?
Hit it with some outreach.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we'll get a better voice the more we get.
Yeah,
the
exactly.
More we get the survey, people just listening, but you know.
I know, but that's the thing is that you're gonna wear them down. You know, I think they'll see that you're trying to include them, and you want to keep them engaged, and it's got to create results, and it's gonna be good for the association. You know, for the neighborhood as a whole to kind of come together.
Offer everyone a free starter. Let's do something.
Yeah. If we could. They got in maybe an invite to this meeting next month.
You're sure I can easily
do that.
I can easily do that. Just let me know.
Kind of press and trying to get
Okay. There you go.
And make them realize it's more of a.
Are you planning on leaving these here?
It affects them.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's
but I'll take back the easels.
I think we're at 30%.
Oh, I don't know. I'm trying to figure out what we're taking.
I'll figure it out.
And Alan.
Yes,
I did have another question about more or less kind of like going back to the sculpture park a little bit. I was wondering if you could give a little bit of detail on what that looks like if, because right now the sculpture park isn't mentioned into that revitalization plan. It'll be in the appendix if it's brought up enough in the comments during the surveys. What does it look like for in the future if I'm fantastic and I get the funding to be able to do said project, does it have just as much weight being in the appendix as it does the actual plan? Or, you know, what, for as an example like that, projects that aren't entirely mentioned in the plan,
mm-hmm.
What does it look like for executing those if we had enough buy-in and we found the funding for that?
Can I
go ahead?
I think that's a great question, Lexi. I think one way we need to look at, and what's good about this plan is only about 12 pages long, right? And you guys can just keep a copy of this and be like, you know what? I want to change this. I want to change this wording of this. And then you bring it to the city and say, we want to amend our neighborhood plan, because that's how it's supposed to be, really. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not supposed to dictate the limit of your vision.
Right.
You know,
we're
supposed to say, we can't fund this, but we can definitely put it in the plan, you know, to so that we have a comprehensive vision. I think that's one of the biggest shortcomings of Pueblo, is lacking that, you know, Disney Tomorrowland, you know, vision of what it's supposed to look like when all the work's done. Because part of planning is that you have to know where you're going in order to find out how you can get there. So just running forward, you could be running in circles, you know. And so, yeah, to address that, I think it should be the policy, and I'll try and bring this up, that these plans are fully amendable by the community even after they've been adopted. I think the step one is just getting something adopted and then giving the plan back to the community which it belongs to keep an eye on and, you know, keep tabs on, try and push forward in any project they can.
I'd like to add on to that, Bart, and like see, our director, you know, he's, I was talking with him about what does implementation look like? And you want to focus on the quick wins, the things that, the strategies that can be achieved 1 to 3 years from now, obviously. But 3 years from now would be, 3 to 5 years from now would be a good time to like revisit the plan, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And does your phone hurt? Does your phone get locked up?
No, that's next door. That's someone here who lives in the road.
Yeah, that's okay. So
So just to reiterate, focus on the quick wins, focus on the things that are achievable, focus on the things that, and then 3 to 5 years from now, revisit it and amend the plan, you know, and work with the city on amending it, because then you've got some things accomplished, and then you take in the new ideas, you know. Oh, that chair is coming down. There you go. Good, that was a save, good save.
Cool.
So, no, and the other thing,
yeah, did you actually see that? I think she saw that.
Yeah.
Not the first time either.
Yeah. Let's get you a different chair. But the other thing you want to emphasize, I know, right? Another thing to emphasize is that this is very, very important. When you're continuing to implement these things and you're advocating for these things, and also when you're getting new ideas, always, always, always think who is the end user in mind? Who is going to be utilizing these things? Not just you, but who in your community is truly going to be using this? And you have to separate yourself. It's easy to like fall in love with an idea because you think it's a great idea. And you might enjoy this idea, but then it might kind of fade away and not many other people might be into it. So you got to always keep in mind that the greatest good will come when you achieve things that will have the greatest impact in your community. So always please keep that in mind, because that's what's going to bring the enjoyment from your community. And that's also going to bring the dollars as well. Make sense? Yeah. We have to be humble in that way. Right?
Yeah. All right. I'd like to wrap our section up. Do you guys have anything else for us?
I don't think so.
No, not for this meeting.
No, I think it's great. It's come a long way since we have those first visioning meetings and all that kind of stuff.
And I would definitely, I guess, put a pitch out.
You guys have brought us into, the Grove is now part of this. Before, it was pretty much not included in any plan in the city.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah, so the Superfund thing got kind of looped it all together.
Mm-hmm. So now we have a unified plan, so it's good.
Yeah.
The only thing I would love to see is the historical survey that started years ago. I know we've already talked about this, to really push that, because that gives us a lot of
that. You'll be seeing a little bit of that pretty soon. And Lexi, you had a comment as well?
I was just going to say, too, for the next steps for this plan is, like they said, after they get all this information and data, there'll essentially be like a final, an amendable final that is then presented to the Planning and Zoning Commission and then the City Council. And I think that would be a really great opportunity for this group, GAP, to be represented well, as well as just show the support for the plan when the time comes. So I'll make sure to stay in touch. Well, I mean, Jeff and Paul are always super in touch, so they'll make sure to let you guys know when those times are. And if you can make it to those meetings, that would be really cool.
I agree 100%, Lexi.
Thank you, Lexi. And that goes for anyone else listening, anyone who learns about this place thing now and then, they can always engage, because there's going to be an opportunity for public comment during the Planning and Zoning Commission too. But definitely we want to see as much comment by July 22nd, as much as possible. Great.
Sure.
Thanks so much for welcoming us. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and end the call, okay?
Okay, hey, bye guys!